Good evening, everyone. Today's topic for discussion is idiopathic macular telangiectasia, and this class would be moderated by Dr. Parveen Sen, madam. The term retinal telangiectasia has been used to describe dilated retinal vessels causing abnormalities such as aneurysmal dilatation, leakage, and exudation. Macular telangiectasia is a descriptive term for various disease entities presenting with incompetence ectasia and irregular dilation of the capillary network affecting only the juxtafoveolar region. Macular telangiectasia type 2 is a progressive neurodegenerative disease of unknown cause with the characteristic alterations of the macular capillary network and neurosensory atrophy. Various terms have been used to describe this disease, such as idiopathic juxtafoveolar telangiectasia, idiopathic parafoveal or macular telangiectasia, focal parafoveal retinal telangiectasiasis, or bilateral paracentral capillary telangiectasia. In the history, in 1982, Gass and Okawa first described this entity as idiopathic juxtafoveolar retinal telangiectasia, as IJFT, and proposed the first classification of disease into four groups. In 1993, Gass and Blody updated this classification and subdivided IJFT into three groups with two subgroups in each as A and B, and till date, it is the most commonly used classification. In 2006, recently, Yanozi et al. Simplified this classification and coined the term idiopathic macular telangiectasia. And macular telangiectasia project coined the term MacTel. Macular telangiectasia project is an international research collaboration among clinicians and bunch of scientists to study idiopathic MacTel. It is a program conducted by Lowy Medical Research Institute, and it aims to improve the clinical understanding, raise the awareness of the disease, and identify cause and appropriate treatments for MacTel. Till date, 8 project reports have been published. The first report is published to describe the vision-targeted health-related quality of life. The second MacTel report was published to describe the baseline characteristics of the patient with MacTel. The third report was published to determine the prevalences of various systemic conditions in the patients of MacTel. In the fifth report, they are published to determine the correlation of autofluorescence findings with the visual acuity in the patients with the MacTel. A sixth report was done to evaluate the progression of MacTel lesions and their correlation with the visual acuity. In the seventh report, they have published the characteristics of the scotomas in the MacTel. And in the last report, that is the latest report 8, they have described the phenotypic findings in the eyes with a substantial vision loss resulting from the MacTel. In the prevalences, when we see the Beaver Dam study in the US, was included 4,790 patients, and they found the prevalence was 0.1%. In the Melbourne collaborative cohort study, they found the prevalence as 0.004% to 0.022%. And analysis from Kenya and Nigeria, and they found the prevalence was 0.6%. This prevalence in these studies found was very less because they had analyzed only the color fundus images, which was only available that time. When we see the classification, the initial Gass and Blody classification has three stages, with each stage divided into A and B subgroups. Yanozi et al. Has divided into two types, type 1 and type 2. And MacTel study group have also divided into type 1 and type 2. For the today's discussion, we are more focusing on the type 2A macular telangiectasia, which is commonly called as parafoveal telangiectasia, as PFT or MacTel. The type 1 IJFT or type 1 IMT, it is aneurysmal telangiectasia, is a congenital disease seen in the males and unilateral, and mean age of presentation is 40 years, and clinically we can see telangiectatic capillaries with the variable sized aneurysms, usually in the area 2-disc diameter around the fovea. Patient can also see present with a macular edema. In FFA, we can see telangiectatic vessels and aneurysmal capillary dilatation straddling along the horizontal raphe causing leakage. And OCT, we can see macular edema with intra and subretinal fluid, but outer retina is not involved in type 1. In differential diagnosis, it has to be differentiated from secondary telangiectasias like vein occlusion, diabetic retinopathy, radiation retinopathy, sickle cell maculopathy, inflammatory retinopathy, Ewing-glass gas syndrome, ocular ischemic syndrome, carotid artery obstruction, and hypertensive retinopathy. And in treatment, we have laser photocoagulation, IVTA, or anti-VEGF injections. Now, coming to the main topic of discussion, that is idiopathic macular telangiectasia or parafoveal telangiectasia. This is the most common type of IJFT. It is acquired, and mean age of presentation is at 55 years. Males and females are equally affected, and disease is bilateral but can be asymmetric. Systemic risk factors associated with the IJFT2 are diabetes mellitus, hypertension, hypercholesterolemia, and obesity. In the study done by Giridhar Anantharaman in 2017 in the Asian population, also found that diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and hypercholesterolemia have significant association with MACTEL. In the MACTEL Project Report 3, they have significantly found the association of diabetes mellitus, obesity, hypertension, and cardiovascular diseases with the MACTEL. This course of the IJFT2A has been subdivided by GAS and BLODY into 5 stages based on FFA and clinical features. The stage 1 and stage 2 patients are asymptomatic. In stage 3 and 4, there will be progressive decreased visual acuity, and stage 5, they will have rapid and severe vision loss. In the stage 1, there will be slight parafoveal graying. In stage 2, along with the graying, there will be superficial refractile particles or crystals can be seen. In stage 3, dilated right-angled venules draining the telangiectasias can be seen. In the stage 4, along with this, retinal pigment epithelial hyperplasia or clumps are seen around the right-angled venules. And stage 5 is characterized by subretinal neovascularization. When we see the pathophysiology, according to Gass et al. Vascular theory, the vascular insufficiency and consequent hypoperfusion that leads to the retinal injury and atrophy. But currently, which is most accepted theory is neurodegenerative theory. That macular telangiectasia is a primarily a neurodegenerative process, and the vascular anomalies are secondary feature of the disease. And Müller cells play a key role in MACTEL. Now, the role of Müller cells are that they provide nutritional and regulatory support both to the retinal neurons and vascular cells. They supply lactate to the highly energy demanding photoreceptor. They protect the photoreceptors by release of neurotrophic factors such as nerve growth factors, brain-derived neurotrophic factors, neurotrophins, and ciliary neurotrophic factors, glutathione. They also play a role in the formation and maintenance of blood-retinal barrier by secretion of factors such as VEGFs and pigment epithelium-derived factors. The new pathological aspect has come forward in the MACTEL that our retinal pigment epithelium pathology is not just restricted to the clinically affected area, but it also covers the entire retina. There is no evidence of ongoing outer segment phagocytosis in the patient of MACTEL. Also, the apical surfaces of RPE appeared abnormal throughout the most of the retina. This reduced outer segment phagocytosis leads to the accumulation of debris in the subretinal space throughout the retina. In this picture, you can see the subretinal debris. In the OCT, and also the in the H and E stain, we can see the subretinal debris between the photoreceptor and the RPE, and between the RPE. And these debris were found throughout the retina, not just at the fovea. histopathologically, you can see in the patients of MACTEL, there will be thickening of retinal capillaries, proliferation of the basement membrane in a multi-layered configuration, and narrowing of the caliber of the lumen, degeneration of pericytes and endothelial cells, and there will be localized endothelial defects in the temporal parafoveal area. The patients with the MACTEL will present with the complaints of impaired reading visual acuity, paracentral scotoma, metamorphopsia, and reduced light increment sensitivity. The article published by Jebo et al., they have found that impaired reading visual reading ability was the most common visual disturbances around in 80% of patients, and the age of presentation was between 50 to 70 years of the age, and metamorphopsia was found in the 12% of the patient. The distance visual acuity remained well preserved over many years, and over the 10 years after the first onset of the symptom, distance visual acuity in the better eye remained more than 20/25 in the 35% patient, and it was less than 20/50 in only 17% of patient. In the MACTEL project report number 7, they have characterized the scotoma in the patients of MACTEL, that 43% of patient were found to have obscure scotomas, 98% of this in the affected in the temporal quadrant, and 99% were unifocal, and the growth of these obscure scotomas was limited to an extent of approximately 40 degrees, not beyond that. Now coming to the clinical findings, the retinal alterations in the MACTEL begin in the temporal paracentral area, and they may eventually affect and characteristic oval region within about 1 disc diameter eccentricity from the foveal center, in where the horizontal diameter is larger than the vertical diameter. Why there is such predilection of the MACTEL in the peculiar area? Gass and Okawa, they suggested that because the presence of more number of arteriovenous crossing in the temporal to the foveal region, which give rise to the chronic low-grade congestion and venous stasis in the temporal paramacular capillaries, and the subsequent consequences. Now the findings which we see clinically are blunting or lack of foveolar reflex. It is blunting will be seen in the early diseases, while in the later diseases FR will be absent. The next we can see the reduced retinal transparency and what is called as retinal graying. This is the first ophthalmoscopical sign we can see, and it is because of increased scattering of light due to structural changes at the affected area. Then next we can see superficial crystalline deposits. They appear as a hyperreflective dots at the anterior surface of the nerve fiber layer, and they are nothing but the remnants of degenerated Müller cells. In the stage 3, in the stage 3 of disease, we can see the telangiectatic capillaries in the both outer and the inner retinal circulations. Then comes the characteristic right angle dilated venules. Normally, when vessels appear to narrow towards the foveola, but in the patients of MACTEL, these vessels appear not to narrow towards the foveola, and they suddenly seem to dive at a right angle into deeper retinal circulation, and they become dilated due to increased blood flow in the paracentral telangiectatic capillaries. You can see in the picture this right angle dilated venules. The next we can see are retinal pigment epithelial plaques and pigment hyperplasia. They are associated with the absolute scotoma, and they originate from the small foci of the hyperplasia of RPE. You can see the pigment plaques. We can also see a pseudovitelliform lesion in patients of MACTEL. They are nothing but the subfoveal accumulation of the photoreceptor debris. Next end stage of disease is characterized by the foveal atrophy. It clinically you can see as a non-prominent cyst or lamellar hole, which is mostly decentered temporal to the fovea. In the natural course of the MACTEL, it is complicated by the subretinal neovascularization in the stage 5, And the neovascularization can cause exudation, neurosensory elevation, intra-subretinal hemorrhages, and fibrovascular proliferation. The neovascularization, which is seen in the macula, now it has the term macular neovascularization has been used for the neovascularization which is seen in the macula. These neovascularization complexes in the macula they originate from the retinal vasculature and they gain access to the subretinal space and develop the chorioretinal shunts. RP hyperplasia and the intraretinal migration, they provide the conduit for abnormal vessels in the subretinal space to proliferate into the sub-RP compartment. The ellipsoid zone loss provide the link between a simple deep capillary dilatation and subretinal neovascularization. Yanozi et al. They have proposed that a pathophysiologic mechanism for subretinal neovascularization in macula, which was similar to the retinal angiomatous proliferation, where the progressive outward proliferation of the deep retinal circulation was fed and drained by retinoretinal and retinal subretinal anastomosis. Gass had proposed that the subretinal neovascularization was primarily derived from retinal vessels, but chorioretinal vascular anastomosis can also occur in the later stage. In Engelbert et al., they have reported that this chorioretinal anastomosis were always preceded by the occurrence of the subretinal neovascularization. In the in this picture, we can see the in the OCT we can see the cystic spaces in the outer retina with the loss of ellipsoid zone, and temporal to the fovea we can see the loss of ellipsoid zone and the hyperreflective neovascular membrane. When we see the OCTA in the superficial capillary plexus, we see the reduced number of capillaries. In the deep capillary plexus, you can see dilated telangiectatic vessels, and in the outer retinal choriocapillary slab, we can see this the neovascular membrane. Article published by Spade et al., they have found that retinochoroidal anastomosis were seen in almost 65% of the eyes, and these anastomoses typically occurred in the multiple clusters of vessel, and the presence of these anastomoses was associated with the pigments and at the right angle veins. For the diagnosing the macula, we have come up with the various multimodal imaging. I will go through one by one. In the OCT, first is this is a non-invasive tool, and it helps to diagnose as well as to monitor the progression of disease. In the OCT, we can see hyperreflective spaces in the inner retina as well as in the outer retina as a retinal cyst. We can see the in this picture at the foveola, the inner lamellar cyst appear as a loss of tissue with the ILM is spanning across it and draping over it. It is called as the ILM drape sign. Also, we can see in this picture this cystic spaces which is draped by ILM. It can and the pigments in the macula can be they are seen as a hyperreflective lesion which casts the back shadowing. This center, we can see the central intraretinal hyperreflective lesion that causes a non-specific posterior shadowing and which corresponds to the hyperpigmented RPE plaques. They are seen anterior to the they are seen over the surface of the retinal nerve fiber at the level of ILM. This picture also shows the pigments which are casting the back shadowing. In the course of the disease, we can see the lamellar hole, and the end stage of disease is characterized by the foveal atrophy with the disruption and the loss of ellipsoid zone. This ellipsoid zone loss is an is an important structural component reflecting the visual function, and when it's it present, it it signifies that there will be the visual prognosis will be worse, and this was published in the MACTEL project report number 6. In the OCT, we can also see the neovascular membrane as a hyperreflective dots in the inner and outer nuclear layers. Best corrected visual acuity, it correlates, we have the in-house publication in which they have correlated the visual function with the foveal slope, and they have found that the best corrected visual acuity correlates better with the slope angles than the central retinal thickness. In which the greater the foveal slope angle, the better will be the vision. Next imaging modality is fundus fluorescein angiography. It was considered as a gold standard to confirm the diagnosis of MacTel till date. The telangiectatic capillaries predominantly seen temporal to the foveola in the early phase, and there will be a diffuse hyperfluorescence in the late phase. This late hyperfluorescence appears to be earlier sign than the telangiectatic alteration, and they appear to originate from the outer retina. In the feature stage 1, we can see the telangiectatic capillaries. In the late phase, we can see the leakage. In the stage 2, the late stage leakage is increasing, and in the stage 3, we can see the dilated telangiectatic capillaries straddling around the foveola, and this late phase hyperfluorescence leakage is increasing in the size. And in the stage 5 of subretinal neovascularization, we can see the leakage from the neovascular membrane. The FFA FFA primarily shows us the superficial vascular network of the retina, and it is inadequate for visualizing the deeper capillary layer and the choroid. The superficial vascular network in the MacTel patients is actually well preserved, and the pronounced changes are evident in the deeper capillary network. The abnormalities may also occur in the deeper vascular network even in the early stage of the disease, in where the OCT is within normal limits and FFA alone is not sufficient to evaluate this patient. So FFA is not ideally suited for evaluating the subretinal and sub-RP neovascularization due to staining and potential leakage from the layers of vessel that are involved in the disease. And it has been shown that FFA finding, which may be evaluated as a perifoveal vascular leakage and lead to unnecessarily injection in the clinical practices. So we have come up with the new imaging modality, OCT angiography, that OCTA enables us separate imaging of the superficial and deep vascular layers and the choroidal vessels. It also provides information regarding disease severity and neovascularization activity. It clearly demonstrates that the leakage simulating choroidal neovascularization on FFA is not just a result of a formation of new vessels, and it is easy to perform and can be repeated frequently and is also non-invasive. In the Nelsi et al., staged the MacTel findings on the OCTA into five grades. In the grade 1, there will be normal superficial capillary network, and only few telangiectatic changes will be seen in the deeper capillary network. In the stage 2, along with the deeper capillary network, the few telangiectatic vessels were seen in the superficial capillary network also, and there will be irregularity in the foveal or vascular zone, and also you can see dilated right angle venules. In the stage grade 3, the foveal vascular zone irregularity will be pronounced, and along with that, there will be vascular invasion that reaching into RP layer. In the stage 4, along with the foveal vascular zone irregularity, there will be subretinal neovascular membrane formation in the outer retina, RP, and the choroid. And in the stage 5, there will be a marked thinning and reduced vascular density in the outer retina, and the very large vascular diameter and subretinal neovascular and reduced vascular density in the subretinal neovascular membrane is seen. In this picture, we can see in the superficial capillary network is normal, and in the deeper capillary plexus we can see dilated and widened vessels, and corresponding OCT is also within the normal limit. So this is the picture of OCT of a very early stage of disease. In this picture, we can see OCTA of superficial in the superficial capillary plexus with no changes in the superficial capillary plexus, while in the outer retina, we can see the neovascular membrane. In the stage 1, the superficial capillary network shows no changes, while in the deep capillary plexus, we can see this mild telangiectatic vessels. And the corresponding OCT is showing the cavitation with the stage 1 macular hole. In stage 2, we can see there is an increase in the space between the vessels in the superficial capillary network. And in the deep capillary network also, we can see that there is increased space between the vessel, and the telangiectasis changes also. In the stage 3 of the disease, in the first picture, we can see that the foveal avascular zone is irregular and there is reduced vascular density in the foveal avascular zone in the superficial vascular network. In the deep capillary plexus, we can see there is a vascular invasion in the foveal avascular zone, and the corresponding OCT also shows with OCT shows the ILM drape sign with the cavitations. In the stage 4 of disease, it shows neovascularization in the deep capillary network, and also the corresponding OCT OCT image also we can see the hyperreflective neovascular membrane. And in this picture, in this image, we can see the stage 5 disease with the neovascular membrane and with the outer retinal atrophy, and this is basically we can see the scarred membrane in the stage 5 disease. In the gray herons, they have published this article, and they have characterized the foveal avascular zone in the patients of MACTEL, and they have found that a circularity index was higher and the superficial parafoveal vascular density was low in the MACTEL patients. The next imaging modality is fundus autofluorescence. In the normally autofluorescent light at 488 nanometer excitation wavelength emanates mainly from the lipofuscin of the RPE. The macular pigments such as lutein, zeaxanthin, they absorb this short wavelength, resulting in the typical appearance of foveal masking, as we can see in this normal autofluorescence image. The any pathological process associated within these retinal layers in the path of autofluorescence, they alter the normal autofluorescence. So what we see in the MACTEL, that first is we can see there will be the loss of normal central attenuation of fundus. This is because of depletion of the luteal pigment and luteal pigment, which leads to the window defect, and it appears as an increased autofluorescence. Also, the next week in the autofluorescence, we can see the localized decreased autofluorescence, and it corresponds to the pigment blocking the normal pigments, which are blocking the normal autofluorescence. And these pigments plaques are typically seen at the end of the right angle venules. In the MACTEL project report number 5, they have seen that the presence of this increased macular autofluorescence and a large area of decreased autofluorescence, and the decreased autofluorescence at the end of retinal vessels at a base, the presence of this at a baseline were significantly associated with the worst visual acuity. The macular pigment density, this is the next modality in which normally the peak concentration at the foveal will be seen at the foveal central, and which rapidly decreases with eccentricity, and very little at the eccentricity is more than 8 degree. In the MACTEL, there will be the central depletion of this macular pigment, and this macular pigment density can be mapped using the subtraction of two autofluorescence images obtained at different wavelengths at 488 and 514 nanometer with a confocal scanning laser ophthalmoscope. And it has a specific characteristic pattern as a loss of macular pigment, which is confined to most pronounced in the area temporal to the foveal center, and no loss of macular pigment at an eccentricity of about more than 6.5 degree in the horizontal axis and more than 5 degree in the vertical axis. This loss of macular pigment has divided into three classes. The class 1, which shows wedge-shaped loss of pigment in the area temporal to the center. In class 2, this area enlarges and involves the foveal center. And in class 3, it is characterized by loss of macular pigment within the oval-shaped area centered on the foveola. Next imaging modality is confocal reflectance imaging, or CBR. It's a blue laser at 488 nanometer, and it is a non-invasive imaging modality, helps us assessing the area to delineate the area and margins which are involved in the macula. The area of increased blue reflectance which is seen is larger than the area which we can area of hyperfluorescence we see in the FFA. So the actual size of the involvement can be made out with this confocal reflectance imaging. The next comes is the multicolor imaging. It is a non-invasive and pseudo depth resolved imaging modality which provides us structural information in an eyes with a macula. Because of its color dependent depth resolution and emphasis nature, it depicts the changes at various anatomical levels. In this first image, we can see the area margins of the involved area very clearly. Involved lesion is seen as a green colored lesion with a well delineated margin. And when we compare the same lesion on the fundus autofluorescence, the margins are not well delineated. The next clinical feature which is the retinal crystals, which appears as a bright green discrete lesion and which is not detectable when we see which is not detectable on the autofluorescence imaging. So the multicolor provides us the overage over the fundus autofluorescence in detecting the retinal crystals. The right angle vessels are seen both on the multicolor imaging as well as on the fundus autofluorescence. The retinal atrophy will be seen as a ill-defined orangish green area with a prominent overlying vasculature, and the corresponding fundus autofluorescence show us the hypoautofluorescence area. The intraretinal pigment hyperplasia will be seen as a dark brown and well-defined lesion with the retinal vessel dipping in it. And the corresponding fundus autofluorescence shows us the hypoautofluorescence lesion. The RPE atrophy will be seen as the area of orangish area because of increased visualization of underlying choroidal vessels, and corresponding FF show us the hypoautofluorescent lesions corresponding to the area of RP atrophy. Subretinal neovascular membrane will be seen as a greenish orange and deep seated lesion, and the corresponding fundus autofluorescence shows us the hypoautofluorescent lesion with the hyperautofluorescence ring surrounding it. Now we come to the treatment part. In the non-proliferative phase, only supportive treatment is required. Unless in the treatment is not required unless the disease is going into a proliferative phase. In the non-proliferative phase, various treatment modalities has been tried, like anti-VEGF. Anti-VEGFs were found to reduce the leakage from the vessels, but when they have seen the visual acuity, there was no improvement in the visual outcomes. Intravitreal triamcinolone laser therapy and carbonic anhydrase inhibitors and carotenoids, these all treatment modalities have also been tried. The next which is coming has a promising future is that ciliary neurotrophic factor. It has been found that this factor is it slows the photoreceptor loss and plays a role in regeneration of cone outer segment in the experimental studies. Among the many growth factors, this ciliary neurotrophic factor is the most effective, but ciliary neurotrophic factor, it degrades relatively quickly when injected into the eye. Therefore, it requires a special delivery device. Currently, the phase 3 trial is going on is about this Renexus, which is an ciliary neurotrophic factor secreting cells. It is an encapsulated cell technology implant which delivers this this factor, and it is implanted into the vitreous. And the very promising results have been seen in the phase 2 trials. In the proliferative phase, when there is a neovascularization, the treatment is similar. Treatment is almost similar what is given in the other diseases with the choroidal neovascularization. And the vascular endothelial anti-VEGFs are they are the standard care, because vascular endothelial growth factor has been implicated as the major angiogenic stimulus which is responsible for the neovascularization in the MACTEL. These anti-VEGF provide, they are seeing the good result, not only improving the visual acuity, but also in resolving the choroidal neovascularization and decreasing the central retinal thickness. The improvement in the visual acuity is seen, and it is also been seen with anti-VEGF that there is a resolution of the subretinal and intraretinal fluid on the OCT, and a regression of the subretinal neovascularization with the cessation of the subretinal neovascular leakage in the, all cases. The leakage from the telangiectasia also decreased, but it used to recur after 6 months, 3 to 6 months of period. Vertiporphyrin PDT is also reported to produce subretinal neovascular obliteration in MACTEL patient, but with a modest visual result. And PDT also leads to the RP atrophy corresponding to the size of laser spot, which can cause more leakage of the retinal vessels into the subretinal space and increase in the size of the neovascularization. Combined PDT with anti-VEGFs have also been tried, but till date the anti-VEGF now the anti-VEGF they have found to be the standard care in the patients with the PFT with CNVM who come with a differential diagnosis. In the patients of IGFT with the foveal atrophy may simulate like a macular hole, and OCT permits for the differentiation between two. The early stage of a disease with a yellow foveal lesion may mimic like a adult vitelliform dystrophy. The retinal crystals can be mistaken for the crystalline retinopathies, but FA readily established the correct diagnosis. Macular pigment plaques with a subretinal neovascular membrane can be mistaken as a age-related macular degeneration, but a drusen and pigment epithelial detachments are generally absent in the MACTEL. So, like to conclude that this MACTEL is a neurodegenerative disease, and OCT-A has replaced FFA in diagnosing the MACTEL. Multimodal imaging has come up with a better understanding of the disease, and anti-VEGF is till now the accepted treatment for PFT with macular neovascularization. There is no therapy available currently to slow down the photoreceptor loss, and this role of neuroprotectors such as CNTF factors, they have a promising future. My acknowledgements. Thank you.
Okay, Shruti, I think you've covered it quite extensively. So, few points that I would add, and then probably we'll go towards a question answer and discussion session. So, one is we all believe that MacTel is limited to the fovea, and you also said only the macular area is involved, as the name says, but then we all believe in contradicting things. So recent publications have said that you could have peripheral changes also. So, but for our understanding, as of now, we are only keeping it at MacTel. And if you look at prevalence of 0.1, so which is quite common, so we also see it very commonly in our OPD. And the Yanuzi classification is a little easy to remember and probably to understand, and which is he is simply divided in proliferative and non-proliferative. The stages are a little bit confusing, and they may not definitely represent progression of disease. You may have MNV or SRNV formation even in the without a pigment hyperplasia happening or without the crystals happening, and the gas and blood eye classification does not speak of atrophic changes. So the classifications are a little wanting there. So if you divide it into proliferative and non-proliferative, that kind of broadly takes care of most of the things. There is a pre-proliferative stage also which is described. Is anybody aware of it? What is a pre-proliferative stage? Shruti, did you come across any publications on pre-proliferative stage?
Yes, in pre-proliferative stage, the neovascularization was seen in the retinal layers, and it has not gone into the sub RP in the sub RP space. There is a publication. Publication by M.M. Joshi group, they have found that epiretinal neovascularization in the patients of MacTel.
Yeah, so that is a little different. What pre-proliferative is that they have seen there is a presence of subretinal fluid or subfoveal detachment in the absence of SRNV. Only problem is that this study, though published recently by the Irwin group, they have not done OCTA. So most likely they believe that proliferation has started in the only in the inner retinal layers and have not yet reached the subretinal space, and without that may be the cause of exudation. So Chetan is repeatedly remarking about fleo, and he's mentioning that it can be familial. So since you mentioned that it is acquired, it is known to be familial, it is known to have a higher, both the twins are affected usually with some genetic predisposition is there, though we have not been able to identify what is the genetic, the gene defect. Also, the very fact that Müller cells are defective and they cause a similar kind of cavitations as you will probably see in XLRS. So you have similar kind of retinal dystrophic and atrophic changes which are happening. So what is fleo? Can somebody explain? Anybody who knows?
Can I interrupt?
Yeah, Vikas.
Actually, there's a gene that has been found. So there are 10 families who had hereditary peripheral neuropathy, and they had this tendency of actually getting their fingers burnt while cooking and stuff like that. So in those patients, Dr. Paul Bernstein at Utah, he's the one who's actually done the work, and this group of patients are called as HSAN1 type of neuropathy. In that, there's a gene called as SCPLT1, which is supposed to be, he found that in 7 families out of 10 that he investigated, and he used fleo as one of the methodologies to pick up MacTel in there. So there is a genetic basis. The gene for MacTel is known. We don't do it very often in our part. Maybe it is time that we should also start doing genetic testing in our series. But the gene is known.
Thanks, Vikas, for your input. So the fleo which has been done in families, and to find out whether the asymptomatic and early stages also can be detected. Can anybody explain what is fleo? What is the full form of fleo? Who will take the answer? So I can see Prantik on the list here. He is there in the class. Yes, Prantik. What is the full form of Leo?
My CR sir has already written there.
Okay, so Shruti, can you explain what is Leo? What does it measure?
I'm not sure, ma'am.
So this is fluorescence lifetime imaging ophthalmoscopy, as Chetan has mentioned. So we know that CBR or the confocal blue reflectance has been found to be early detection of macular. It is very useful. So what happens is when you look at fluorescence, is that a molecule gets activated, and from a baseline it goes to a higher level. And then we all know the property of fluorescence is it has to come back to a normal level, correct? And when it comes back to a normal level, it releases energy. So the time that the excited molecule stays at a higher level of excitation is what is measured by Fleo. So not only is it defective, but in early stages, it may remain at a higher level, at a shorter period of time, so it measures the time that it takes to come back to normal also. So how long the fluorescence remains. So it is one step next, and that has been used in families to detect MacTel even in otherwise clinically normal looking children of affected parents, is what Chetan has commented. So coming back to more basic stuff, is that can you explain more on why do we have, what is the normal fundus autofluorescence in a normal eye? What does it look like? What is the macula look like? What does the paramacular area looks like? And how is it different from what you see in a patient with MacTel?
Yes, ma'am. In the normally at the fovea, because of the presence of the pigments, we will see the hypofluorescence, that is what is called as masking of autofluorescence, and surrounding the fovea in the macular region, it will be what we'll see as a normal autofluorescence.
Yeah, so in the norm, even in normal eyes, you have something called the dark macula, and the dark macula is because of the presence of melanin or lutein and zeaxanthin pigments, which are present in the macula. So in patients of MacTel, since there is deficiency of lutein and zeaxanthin, this pigment is lost. So you don't have this masking effect of lutein and zeaxanthin. So as a result, the macular area also becomes hyperfluorescent. So it is almost like a window defect or an unmasking effect. So you mentioned the two wavelengths which are used for your MPOD, which is that 488 and 514. So what is that? That is very important to understand, then only it has any meaning. Why we are using those two wavelengths? So that is the basis of CBR also. Why we are using those two wavelengths? I think you will be the only one who will be able to answer this, because I don't think others would have. Anybody else who can answer this question? Yeah, so the peak absorption, you are right.
The fluorescence what we get is the light which is reflected back, but in the melanin and the zeaxanthin absorb the light in that area. So we get a hypoautofluorescence imaging of the macular region.
Yeah, so 488 is where, that is, you're close, Sushant. 488 is where the absorption spectrum, the fluorescence is maximum for the lutein and zeaxanthin. And 410, it is zero, almost nearly zero. And for the lipofusion shows you a reflectance in both the wavelengths. So if you measure at 488, it is by lipofusion plus lutein and zeaxanthin. If you measure at 415, it is only by lipofusion. So when you do a digital subtraction of the two, you get indirect measure of how much is the fluorescence by the lutein and zeaxanthin. So this gives you the difference approximate measure of the pigment density. And this particular thing, and there are a lot of publications on this, this is what is being used to look at the autofluorescence in MacTel. So coming to some features on OCTA, you mentioned the right angle vessel is one of the most peculiar findings that you see here. So which layer do you see the right angle vessel most often?
In the deep.
Yeah, okay. It's in the?
Deep retinal plexus.
Actually, it can be present both in the deep and superficial, which is why I raised this question since you had mentioned it in the deep. So it can be present in both. So since you have said that the OCTA is the investigation of choice, so do you think we can only do OCTA in these patients and we need not do any other investigation, or you still would want to do some other investigation? So most of the pictures which you showed, the OCT cavitations had actually almost nothing to do with the OCTA features. You yes. saw that you marked it at stage one, describing the OCTA microvasculature. Yet there were large cavitations, almost like a macular hole formation. So, so these two don't seem to go hand in hand. So, which is why you would definitely look at the OCT B scans. You cannot give them up if you really want to understand the whole disease process. Why the ILM drape sign is not seen in idiopathic lamellar macular holes or full thickness macular holes and only seen in MacTel? Who's going to give the answer for that? And after that, I'm coming to management of macular hole also. Chetan has put up the question. So who's going to give the answer to that? Anybody's volunteering?
Ma'am, in the in macular hole, the pathology is different. It is because of the PVD and the separation because of which there is a hole. In MacTel, the pathology is not related to PVD. So that's why.
Yeah, so you have basically the cavitations which have formed due to the collapse of the photoreceptors or the molar cells because there is not enough support. That is why the ILM has nothing to do with it. ILM is intact, yet because of the collapse of the cells, there is these cavitations which have formed. In idiopathic macular holes, the whole underlying pathogenesis is because of the tangential traction of the ILM. So the ILM is actually pulling the things apart. If it were intact, it is then probably the hole may not form in there. It was just covering the whole thing passively, then it may not exert the traction. So, Chetan, would you like to comment upon it? The macular hole surgery in MacTel patients?
Yeah, so I have done a case of a macular hole which is developed in a patient. One is that we all know that it's a Müller cell disease. So the ILM is not really very easy to peel off. And when you peel it off, you're hardly having any tissue underlying that. So when you do that, and we are basically hoping that the macular hole gets bridged by a glial proliferation. Now this is because there's the basic defect is also, it's a neurodegenerative disease. So you have a basic defect in the Müller cells also, and they are the ones which are actually they lead to a glial proliferation, bringing the whole edges closer and finally healing it. This does not happen in a routine MacTel cases with a macular hole. So macular hole generally does not do well when you do a macular hole surgery. The traditional concept of peeling the ILM and then maybe using the ILM to using it as a flap as closing this thing. So because the basic healing, the glial proliferation that has to occur does not occur. So actually it's not really a great surgery to do because your success rates are not good. So preferably you can just leave it. You know, try to do a macular hole peeling surgery because as Prasad just said, it's not related to the hyoid, the traction that is caused by the hyoid or by the ILM. It is just a defect which is just progressed to a full thickness defect.
Correct. So I agree there. So there is definitely the pathology and the way these holes are forming is different. So a lot of publications, not many on how to treat it, but people have used autologous serum, or they have used autologous blood, or they have used amniotic membrane or a peripheral retinal flap. This situation, I think you will need to do something out of the box to close it. Dr. Kumar Saurabh is here. I think he has some publications on use of multicolor in MacTel also. Kumar, would you like to add your experience on this?
Yeah, hello, good evening, ma'am. Actually, multicolor and both the blue reflectance images are very handy to pick very subtle changes of MacTel when the crystals and RP atrophy and even OCT findings are not there. So in those patients, we on multicolor, if we see, then we see a greenish hue around the fovea. And it is present in both eyes. One eye may be an asymmetrical presentation, and that gives a diagnosis or clue that patient is having a early stage of PFT. And regarding the blue reflectance, as we know that blue reflectance is very useful in detecting again early features, and it shows an hyperreflectance zone around the involved area. And when we do reflectance imaging in PFT or MacTel, then we need to consider that if we keep on lighting or keep on taking the images for say around 30 seconds or more, or if we do blue reflectance image at the end of all OCT and everything, then we may not get that hyperreflectance, which is very characteristic of MacTel because of the bleaching effect. So blue reflectance, hyperreflectance on the blue reflectance imaging should be done in the beginning of the test, beginning of all the investigations, or if it is being done at the end of OCT and everything, then at least there should be 5 minutes or preferably 15 minutes gap from OCT or from any source of light to let the eye adapt, get the dark adaptations, then do the reflectance image. That is very important, ma'am.
So, ma'am, I just want to think, so this is actually one of the cases where you have a reverse meso phenomena, which Dr. Saurabh has just mentioned. One of the cases where you have reverse meso phenomena when you have complete bleaching. And then you see the bright reflex slowly disappearing.
Yes, sir. That's right. Because if the light is after prolonged light exposure, the not just the peripheral involved area of PFT, the other areas also get bleached and they become hyperreflective. So entire thing gets hyperreflective. It's a bleaching effect. Everything becomes bright. So the brightness of the involved area is overshadowed. So dark adaptation is important. So that's why we should do in the early, in the beginning or after a period of dark adaptation.
So that's a very important point that you highlighted. Ma'am, you would want to say something? Dr. MP, ma'am?
Yeah, very nice class, Shruti, and good discussion. Just to add on to Kumar's comment, this can happen even if you're examining the patient in the OPD. So very often somebody keeps on staring with this 78D, and then you find that when you go to see the patient, everything looks all right.
Correct.
So it's not only with the reflectance imaging, it's also clinical. And then you go back to try and explain to your fellow that no, nothing is there. So I think this is something that is visible even on clinical examination, that if you keep on looking at the light, sometimes the grayish reflex disappears.
Right.
Okay, so yes, Kumar, you would like to add something else?
No, I agree, ma'am. The grayish thing which we see on with indirect ophthalmoscopy also subsides, as Dr. MP Madam was saying. That's true.
Thanks for your input. So coming to OCTA, so we know that most of the SRNB which are formed are have the origin in the retina. We also have these RCA formations in AMD. So anybody can mention what is the difference between this kind of RCA in MacTel and what you see in a RAP lesion in AMD, since you are the one who is prepared for the class? Did you come across some publication or some material mentioning how does the RCA in MacTel different from what you would see in a RAP lesion or type 3 CNV in AMD patients? Sant, you want to answer that?
Ma'am, the RCA complex arising in this will always be having its origin in the retinal layers, while that of RAP can have the origin either in the retina or as well in the choroid, which can meet at level of.
So most of the times, I think most important that the pigment epithelial detachments are not so often seen in a MacTel RCA vis-a-vis RP lesion, which you would see in AMD patients. MP ma'am, would you like to add on to some, because this often this question is also discussed and comes to the mind that how these two RCA are different.
Yeah, basically, I think the article by Spade suggests that MacTel may also have a choroidal component. And that is why you have the RCA formation in the late phases. Basically, it is a question of which came first. Is it the superficial one that went deeper or the deeper one that came superficial? It's something like the chicken and the egg. But like you mentioned, the pigment epithelial detachment is very, very rare in MacTel. I have one case with the pigment epithelial detachment, but nothing more than that. So yes, they more have more of a fibrovascular pigment epithelial detachment in patients with AMD, which is lacking in MacTel. So I would say probably those are the differences. And if you're looking in at a MacTel-like picture in a young patient, MacTel-like RCA in a young patient, there are more chances you're looking at an RCA secondary to an inflammatory pathology like toxo or something, and not MacTel itself. So that's just one thing to be kept in mind.
Yeah, so the exudation, whether it is in form of fluid or it's in form of lipid or it's in form of pigment epithelial serous detachments, they are all more in cases of AMD RAP lesions vis-a-vis retinochoroidal anastomosis seen in MacTel eyes. And if you see, usually in the OCT, before an RCA is formed, you see a collapse of the outer nuclear layer so that now the deep plexus almost comes in contact or closer to the Bruch's membrane. And that is where the communication may happen. If you are doing SSOCTA for these patients, there is a very nice image which is formed available on SSOCTA, which is called the composite color-coded NFAS image. All of you would have seen on the left side, usually whenever you see the reports, that you have this kind of all three layers are depicted together, where the superficial is vessels are shown by red, the deep is by green, and any flow in the outer retina is by blue. So this can give you a very good indication. But the moment you see a blue color flow, that there is a capillary invasion of the outer retina. So these are the eyes where you should see them very carefully and make sure that your segmentation is correct. Look at the avascular slab, and if you see any flow and capillaries or blood vessels in the avascular slab, it is what you should suspect, presence of a SRNV beginning to happen, even in the absence of any changes on OCT. Yes, Chetan, please add your points.
No,
Chetan,
no,
would like to add?
Yeah. No, additional points, ma'am. I agree with all those points.
DAD ma'am, you would like to add something? DAD ma'am is here.
Yeah, Parveen, no, everything has been covered and good extensive discussion has taken place. Thank you so much. I have nothing to add.
Jayaprakash, you have mentioned something regarding pigment plaques. Would you like to elaborate on that?
No, ma'am. She had called that as RP plaques. So I don't agree to calling them as RP plaques actually, because they are superficial. So the pigments may have migrated from the RPE. So I feel that we should not call them as RP plaques when they are superficial, in the superficial layer.
So that is correct. I agree with you. So these are pigment plaques which are there. And and usually this pigment you will see along the right angle vessel, and once you see that is the conduit for the growth of the SRNV also. So you'll have neovascularization also coming in from there. Just few points about the treatment. So since we are giving VEGF in proliferative stage, can we give VEGF in non-proliferative also? That also causes edema, and we know VEGF can reduce edema. So, Shruti, can we give VEGF in non-proliferative stage?
Yeah, ma'am. There are reports in that they have given the anti-VEGFs in the non-proliferative stage, and they have found that the late phase leakage, which is seen in the FFA, has been after anti-VEGF induction, it was reduced. But visually, in the visual prognosis, there was no much difference, and the leakage after 3 months or with us after period of 6 months, the leakage again it started leaking. So they had concluded that in the non-proliferative phase, actually there is no need of treatment. Only the treatment which can be which we can consider is neuroprotection.
So actually, not only not needed, anti-VEGF can be non-neuroprotective also. So we need neuroprotection here, particularly in MacTil. So this is particularly one reason why we should not be giving the VEGF on a regular basis in non-proliferative stage. Ma'am, MP, ma'am?
I'll just add a word here. There's a series from Arvind actually, where patients with non-proliferative MacTil but with neurosensory detachment under the fovea, they did well with anti-VEGF agents. So that is a small series of I think 5 or 6 cases. Yeah.
Yeah, ma'am. We discussed that in the beginning. They have labeled it pre-proliferative MacTil, where they have shown subfoveal detachment. But only I thought the limitation was that they have not done OCTA in those cases. So maybe we are looking at early, new vessel forming, which is still in the deep plexus and has not yet invaded the to form of RCA. So maybe that can be the cause. They have also discussed it like that. So, but VEGF has a role there. OCTA, I think, could have picked up the reason for the foveal detachment. Yes, I agree.
I've seen this happen in patients post cataract surgery with non-proliferative MacTil, and they have settled down with just topical anesthetics. But that was immediately post cataract surgery.
Anybody has any points to add?